It's the ways in which we unwittingly perpetuate racism through our structures, through our, even through our spirituality.
Those very same counties that overproduce debt, right, are the same counties that clear the fewest felonies, lowest percentage of felonies.
And they really don't have much context or history about the salience of race as an issue in the United States.
I'm Brian Wade. Watch me every week on this station.
Ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. Worlds Apart is a program that looks to investigate how racism, ethnocentrism, cultural, and social divide manifest themselves within our society. Worlds Apart will consider the historic, scientific, cultural, and social factors that perpetuate these issues. Additionally, Worlds Apart was created to serve as a constructive dialogue piece around racial and social divide, a topic that oftentimes is uneasy to broach. We're appreciative to be now entering into our 11th year and want to say to you Happy New Year and happy holidays. And this year, as some of you may well know, I've relocated to the state of North Carolina, but we continue to produce our programs in the state of Pennsylvania, and we're looking forward to creating a series of innovative programs that will look in terms of how we're doing in terms of addressing some of the issues such as in healthcare and education, a lot of the issues Worlds Apart has broached. So we're looking to update some of the information from our guests from years ago just to see where we are in our society. But I'm privileged today to as a result of my networking in the state of North Carolina, have Dr. Howard Lee as our guest via the phone from Raleigh, North Carolina. And at this time, I'd like to introduce him to my viewing audience, the Worlds Apart viewing audience. As you well know, that the issue of education, specifically around disparities in academic achievement and dropout rates, are not only endemic within certain states but across the United States. And Dr. Lee is aggressive in trying to remediate and address some of these issues. So at this time, I'd like to introduce to my viewing audience Dr. Howard Lee. Dr. Lee, welcome to Worlds Apart.
Well, thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here and to be a part of this.
Okay, thank you so much. Yes, give us some background about yourself, Dr. Lee.
I am chairman of the North Carolina State Board of Education currently, prior to taking on this position. In addition to being a member of the state's Utilities Commission, I was in the North Carolina Senate for 13 years. And prior to that, I was in the cabinet of Governor Jim Hunt when he was governor in the 1970s. Prior to that, I was mayor of Chapel Hill, North Carolina. I have been on the faculties of Duke and North Carolina Central University and the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. And I'm married and have three grown children and two grown grandchildren. And just delighted to have the privilege of continue to be involved in education. I began my educational involvement at Duke University when I was doing research under a Ford Foundation grant looking at the difficulties faced in the educational arena by poor children in the Durham City Schools. And just a few days ago, I was reading an article I wrote in 1967 based on the struggles these kids faced. And it seems to me the progress we've made and the problems that were existing then are very similar to the problems we're struggling with today. The only difference is that the kids today have many more outside interferences, mm-hmm. such as television and iPods and many other things that tend to be a distraction to them, which was not the case in the 1960s.
Well, that's interesting, Dr. Lee, because a lot of the work that this program done does bears you out, not that it needs to bear you out, but when you looked at the Kerner Commission report, I don't know if you're familiar with that report back in 1968 that Patrick Moynihan had created that talked about, you know, two nations, separate and unequal, black and white. And you look at the research now currently out of schools like Harvard, where it talks about racial segregation in public schools are now even more pronounced, and the achievement gap, where there may have been some gains, the gap still exists. So it's just interesting. It seems like either we haven't learned our lessons, or we're not really as diligent as we say we want to be in addressing these issues. Your thoughts?
Well, I'm convinced, first of all, when one takes a look at the nation's commitment to education, I'm convinced beyond a shadow of a doubt that we're not really serious about education in our country. And I'm not sure that we really want to educate all of the kids and to give every child a chance. Now, that's a broad statement to make, and certainly time won't permit us to go into greater detail. But
right.
I just don't find the resources, for example, being put into the schools that have the greatest need, schools in poor areas serving minority kids. We just take North Carolina, for example, and look in the eastern part of our state. When we look at Hertford County, Bertie County, Northampton County, Halifax County, these are counties that are serving large minority populations, and in this case, black and Latino, Hispanic. But they're also serving poor kids, and they are poor white kids who are caught up in this net.
That's right.
I just feel that our commitment to education is fine when it comes to the areas where there is strong political influence and where the areas are very wealthy. But when it comes to equalizing opportunity for all our children, and as chairman of the State Board of Education, I watch this and cringe at the numbers of kids we're losing who are dropping out and who are being expelled and who are just struggling just to try to stay alive. So I'm really concerned that the progress we think we have made in educating our kids is more of a fantasy than it is a reality.
Right. Dr. Lee, I know in the Wilmington Journal you talked about partnerships, you know, in terms of involving a holistic approach in addressing public education with respect to closing the achievement gap. How are those initiatives going?
Well, they're certainly showing some real signs of promise. You know, it's amazing. I wrote an article in 1967, as I may have mentioned, and it's still very much the same. But even then, we were trying to create partnerships. But fast forward to the present time, and I find that if we are to be successful in our schools, we must have partnerships with faith-based institutions, especially the churches, where we have a lot of talent that can be brought to bear in support of these kids. We are looking at trying to better engage fraternities and sororities, and I'm delighted to say that some progress is being made there. We can find pockets of success, but still, when I look at the entire state of North Carolina, we have a long ways to go to be able to maximize the impact of these various entities on helping us support these kids and move them forward in their educational pursuits.
Dr. Lee, what we need to do now is pause some words from our sponsors. If you're just now tuning in, I have with me Dr. Howard Lee, who's the chairman of the North Carolina State Board of Education. He's my guest, and he's on the phone from Raleigh, North Carolina. And I also want to give a shout out to my son. He's at graduate school at North Carolina State University. I want to say hi to Brian. So what we'd like to do is pause some words from our sponsors. Stay tuned. We'll be back to Worlds Apart.
Looking to buy or sell your home? Contact Monica Archie. Several years of real estate experience. Make the right choice for your realtor for life. Monica Archie.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by The Bonton.
Hi, my name is Dr. Stephen Jones, and I've written a wonderful book titled 7 Secrets of How to Study. How many of you have a student that's struggling in school, trying to take tests, thinking about their motivation level, knowing that they're not ready or able to get the types of grades that they would like? Well, I've written this book, 7 Secrets of How to Study, to show them what they need to do to manage their time, to get organized, and to make sure that they're eliminating all stresses as they're preparing for each individual test. I've also written a book for parents to help parents know how to organize and help their students to do better in school. And I'm writing a scholarship book that should be forthcoming. I want you to have a student that knows exactly what they need to do when they go to every class, how they should manage their time, how they should prepare for difficult examinations, and let them know that there's a resource that they can do to train themselves to do better in every class. You have potential to be successful if you will use this book, and you will have an A on every class.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by Wolf Printing.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just now tuning in, I have with me on the phone via the phone from North Carolina, Raleigh, North Carolina, Dr. Howard Lee, and he's the chairman of the North Carolina State Board of Education. He's my guest. I want to thank you again, Dr. Lee, for taking out, you know, time from your busy schedule to be on the program. Dr. Lee, when we look at the issue of suspensions and expulsions, and specifically from an ethnic perspective, we continue to see this wide disparity as far as its impact on African-American male children. Talk about that and what's being done to try to curb that trend in your state.
Well, that is a disturbing trend that we've become more vigilant in trying to better understand and respond to. And I don't know if there's any one factor that contributes to that. Certainly we recognize that black children, and especially poor black children, are caught between two worlds. There is a standard in their community which they are expected to maintain, and a behavior pattern that seems to be more acceptable.
Mm-hmm. Culture influences.
And then there's a standard in school, and sometimes these two different things clash, and it puts the kid in a tremendous vice of trying to go back and forth between these two worlds. Mm-hmm. We know that many of these boys, especially who are coming out of households where there is no male, tend to have a greater chance of having a run-in with authority, and so we think that is a contributory factor that we would like to be able to find ways to remedy. But we also believe there's a low tolerance level within the school. We can't prove that, and we're trying our best to see if that indeed is true. We're showing some signs of improvement with behavior in school, and certainly kids being exposed. What I'm hoping we can do is sometimes kids behave and get themselves expelled because it's like throwing a rabbit in the briar patch. They're having difficulty in school. They are not given the kind of support that they need in order to believe in themselves and to raise their self-esteem. And so getting out sometimes seems to be the easiest way, and being expelled certainly is a quick way of doing that.
Right.
So we're putting more pressure on the school not to just go and kick kids out, but find ways to remedy whatever the problem is, and at the same time maintain their responsibilities to have a safe environment in which other kids can learn. We have a tremendous problem with bullying, and we are training staff on how to manage bullying. And we're also having guidance counselors spend more time with kids in identifying the potential for bullying other kids before it gets to the point where somebody is expelled. Those are a number of things that that we're attempting to do. But again, it's kind of like going uphill and trying to keep the sand from coming down on you. It just keeps coming.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Lee, let me ask you this.
Some signs of hope, and mm-hmm. that sign has to be in the fact that as kids are more successful in school,
Dr. Lee,
less likely to act out.
Dr. Lee, let me ask you this, though. You know, you talked about, I guess, some tolerance. What have you done, or what is the state doing in terms of the issue of cultural competency? Do you think that, in some sense, some of these tensions could be contributed to maybe a sort of a cultural disconnect as far as communicating to students? I know that in the programs that I'm going to be doing later, I have a consulting group that specializes in diversity training and consulting. Has the state done anything to try to address that issue in terms of cultural competency?
Well, not as much as we need to. We certainly try to integrate an understanding and a clear indication of what people's responsibilities are, especially teachers, in our staff and professional development. I was on the faculty at the School of Social Work at UNC, and one of the things that I discovered during my time there is that social workers had similar challenges as do many of our teachers, because social workers were working with poor and mostly black clients, and teachers are now, who are white in school, they're working with black kids. Everybody intends to do well, but if you don't have an understanding and an uneasiness with crossing that line, it makes it difficult to relate. So we feel that it's our obligation to try and have an impact on the attitude of people so they will understand the cultural differences and be able to respond to those. It's a tough challenge for someone who hasn't been in the environment and who are strange to it. I've had conversation with the president of the Consolidated Universities here at UNC, Mr. Erskine Bowles, and it said to him that our schools of education will need to integrate as a part of their curriculum an emphasis on cultural differences, because we're graduating students and sending them into these challenging schools where the kids in many instances are poor or black or Hispanic, and they're going in not understanding how to work with these kids, and they're getting frustrated. They're frustrating the kids. The kids are reacting, so it's a never-ending circle.
Right.
So we are putting a lot more emphasis on trying to prepare teachers and administrators to understand the cultural differences and not overreact to a behavior that sometimes is misinterpreted. Mm.
Dr. Lee, we have like a minute and a half. Let's talk about the socioeconomic sort of conditions. I know that in North Carolina, you have countywide school systems, and I guess school systems vary from state to state. But in terms of a holistic approach in dealing with public education, are there any specific economic strategies that the state Board of Education is looking to implement as far as trying to equitize school funding and that type of thing within your state?
Yes, we've done a great deal in that area. As you might know, we've been under a court order, and the court has demanded that we put additional funds into these low-wealth schools. We have a special fund set aside specifically for low-wealth schools. We have a small school fund that provides additional resources for these schools. We have grants that the governor has made available for these schools. We're putting a lot of emphasis on ensuring that any child who graduates from high school will be able to go to college, whether the family has money or not. We believe that so many of these kids think they can't afford to go to college, and therefore they don't put this as a part of their high priority. So we are piling a lot of money into these schools. To me, it is not just a matter of resources anymore.
Right.
It is a matter of getting good qualified teachers into these schools and having those teachers understand the children with whom they're working and to stay there long enough to do some good. So in that regard, in one school system, we've tried a test pilot in building first-class housing, some luxury townhouses for teachers who will go there and stay. We're looking at giving teachers students free admission to the university system if they will go and stay in a certain county. We're trying every conceivable creative approach under the sun in hopes that we can get some stability in these schools. Many of these schools are unstable because the people who are in the schools are unstable, or we can't get them to go to schools at all.
Okay. Dr. Lee, thank you. What we're going to do now is pause some words from my sponsors. If you're just not tuning in, I have with me on the phone from Raleigh, North Carolina, Dr. Howard Lee, who is the chairman of the North Carolina State Board of Education. He's my guest, and we're going to go into our last segment. Stay tuned. We'll be back to Worlds Apart.
Whether it's in the city, the country, or somewhere in between, owning your own home means something special, something comfortable and secure. No wonder it's a dream we all share. We're the Pennsylvania Housing Finance Agency, working to put safe, affordable housing within reach of every citizen. Find out more by visiting phfa.org, because it doesn't have to be just a dream.
Hershey Foods Corporation supports the efforts of Worlds Apart in promoting the understanding, acceptance, and value of diversity.
At WellSpan Health, we understand what women need and what women want. That's why we've created something unique for our region. Healthcare programs, diagnostics, and treatments exclusively for women. We call it Well Women at WellSpan. Special care and insightful information for everything from high-risk pregnancies to midlife health and more. Well Women at WellSpan. Don't you love it when someone really understands your needs?
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by the Bonton Stores Foundation.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just now tuning in, I have on the phone from Raleigh, North Carolina, Dr. Howard Lee, who is the chairman for the North Carolina State Board of Education, and we're looking specifically at what's happening in the state of North Carolina. As some of you may know, I've relocated to the North Carolina area, and so I'm enjoying the weather there. I know right now in Pennsylvania it's like maybe 30-35 degrees, and last week in North Carolina it was like 70 degrees, so I'm saying, boy, that's worlds apart. But anyway, I'm enjoying my time in North Carolina, and I have Dr. Lee with me. Dr. Lee, As you may know, I had State Representative Earlene Parman on the program, and she chairs the education for the House of Representatives. And we were talking about the dropout rate, and I believe in 2005, 2006, you had over 22,000 students that dropped out, which is unfortunate. And I know you sort of broached that issue. Is it just money, though, that's going to turn these kinds of trends or patterns around, or what else will it take? Will it take churches being more strategic, or the state creating more alliances with churches? It's because I'm working in mental health in the state of North Carolina now with clients who have been diagnosed with ADHD, ODD, and those types of mental health issues. And it just seems like there's so many things that I guess can impact why the dropout rate. But do you have maybe a top one or two that you're looking to address to stem that tide?
Yeah, I obviously don't have the answer for what to do to stem the tide of dropouts. If I did, I'd be on the speaking circuit. But here are some concerns that I have,
and
we are as guilty as anyone else. We have never stopped and asked the kid who dropped out of school why he or she dropped out of school. Mm-hmm. And until we do that, we're not, frankly, going to be able to design the kind of responses that that are needed. Now, I've been trying to get the governor here to let me put on a dropout summit, and it turns out that while we've been talking, Mississippi has already gone ahead and scheduled a dropout summit.
Wow.
With the support from State Farm Insurance and the organization that Secretary Colin Powell started called America's Promise.
Right, exactly.
Now, I did meet with these folk last week, and they're looking to come to North Carolina, and we're going to sit down and talk with them about this kind of dropout summit.
Right.
As you well know, or may not know, Representative Parman influenced the Speaker of the House here to appropriate $7 million.
Exactly.
To attract some grants and proposals for local communities to try and stem the dropout tide. So a lot of efforts are in place to try to do that. We've got to, however, ultimately tie whatever we do to helping kids develop a clearer self-esteem and value so that they can see themselves as being as competent as anyone else to succeed educationally. Then we have to really tie this whole process of showing them how they can get from where they are to where they need to be. And there are several youngsters who've gone through North Carolina State and UNC who were dropouts, who came from poor families, and I'm trying to get them out across the state to meet with a lot of these kids to try and encourage them along. There is no simple answer to the dropout problem, but I am alarmed, and I called together a group of black leaders about two months ago and said, I'm sounding the alarm. There is a crisis in the black community with kids dropping out of school. And we need more people who are willing to work with these kids and prop them up and give them support to at least get them believing in themselves and believing that they can survive in the system. And we're going to have to keep doing things like that, but there is no simple answer to it. And we've been struggling with it for years, and I think it's, but it's one of those things we can't give up on.
Right. Well, Dr. Lee, and one of the things that I've always, I guess, challenged communities to do is to use the medium of television more constructively or strategically. Do you have in place of using television in a way that, as you're having these kinds of sessions, that they can be tapped through their community access stations throughout the state in terms of getting this information out? And I'd be willing to work with you, but I think that we underutilize, media resources in terms of getting this kind of information out. Your thoughts?
You're absolutely correct. I have a friend here, Don Curtis, who owns a chain of radio stations, the biggest being WPTF here in Raleigh. Mm-hmm. And Don has said to me, I think I can be a very good help if we could come up with a plan for me to begin to have some public service announcement appealing to kids to stay in school and not drop out. We're talking about that as an option. No one here is using television, to my knowledge, to do that, and I think it would be a wonderful thing to do. I do know one of the local radio stations, 850, they call it The Buzz, really praises students who are athletes and who do well in school, encouraging them to be academically committed.
Right.
But to the extent you are mentioning, and I think your idea is absolutely on target, we have not used the media to achieve what we could through that.
Right. And in closing, I know that one of North Carolina's finest, Fantasia, had experienced a dropout. You know, has anybody thought about getting in contact with her now that she's gotten a status and maybe use her as a way to promote that kind of initiative?
We have talked to her about that. She's so busy right now, you can't really get to her.
Right.
I saw her about 6 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, she's just tied up with this play on Broadway.
Right, The Color Purple.
Is not able to do very much,
right.
But she's certainly open and willing and is very committed to wanting to do something.
Mm-hmm.
And Oprah Winfrey has been talking, too, about how to use that and contribute it.
Right.
So we those are things that are on the drawing board, but nothing is coming out of it right now.
Right. Well, I look forward to working with you in the future because I know you have a consortium of historically black colleges, and I think if they can work in conjunction with churches, with, you know, the State Board of Education in terms of sharing resources, I think, you know, we can sort of make a dent in that issue. But Dr. Lee, I want to thank you so much for your time and appearing on the program, and I wish you continued success. And again, I look forward to, and I would like the opportunity to work with you as you move forward on these kinds of issues. So again, Dr. Lee, thank you for being my guest on this program.
It's been my pleasure, and I look forward to staying in touch.
Okay, take care of yourself, Dr. Lee.
All right.
Again, that was Dr. Howard Lee, and for Worlds Apart, we're thankful for being able to bring you this program. What we're going to do is prepare for our next program. So for Worlds Apart, I'm Brian Wade. Good evening, good night, and God bless.
The African American History Minute. Today's trivia question is, who was the first African American quarterback to win the Super Bowl? The minute's featured African American is Tony Dungy. Head coach of the NFL's Indianapolis Colts, Dungy was born in Jackson, Michigan on October 6, 1955. He graduated from Parkside High School. He attended the University of Minnesota, where he played quarterback from 1973 to 1976. Dungy later signed as a free agent with the Pittsburgh Steelers.
In the NFL, everybody has talent. There's a lot of good athletes that play, but if you want to be successful and you want to achieve goals as a team, you got to have good quality people.
Head coach of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers and now with the Indianapolis Colts, boasting one of the best coaching records in the league, who was the first African-American quarterback to win the Super Bowl? The answer is Doug Williams. Until next time, remember, we're standing on the shoulders of giants.
When we stand in-